Click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ikeda.
Hello friends, today we are going to discuss about the scheduling type of an operating system of Linux. How the scheduling algorithm is implemented? First, it was we go of one scheduling algorithm. After then, it is moved to the CFS or completely fair scheduling algorithm. So how the scheduling algorithm are different from each other and what are the advantages of each type over the other? Linux had a very primary and interesting scheduling algorithm history of itself. The versions prior to 2.5 uses a traditional Unix scheduling algorithm policies. But as we know that this policy doesn't adequate support for SMP architecture. And it also led poor performance for the larger number of processes in a multiprocessor or symmetric multiprocessing system. Now to improve this performance, first the version 2.6 was overhauled with the application developer of a scheduling algorithm known as BigO(1). This BigO(1) scheduling algorithm provides support and it was excellent for the SMP architecture. Now as it was supported for the SMP architecture, it also gives the access to a larger number of processes. Now it will finish the task within a predetermined time and it is fixed one, it is regardless of the number of processes that is present in the system. But although it provides excellent support for the multiprocessor, it also led to poor performance and response time for interactive processes that are common in some desktop computer system. During the development of the version of 2.6 kernel of this Linux architecture, this scheduling algorithm was revised. And on the release of 2.6.23 version, the Linux kernel uses a completely fair scheduling algorithm or CFS as the default algorithm of a Linux kernel. Now, Linux scheduling is done with the scheduling classes. Each class has a specific type of priority based on it. Now, the processes should belong to any scheduling class to actually get activated or allocated the CPU. Now the Linux kernel provides with different scheduling classes as with the advantages of it can provide different scheduling algorithm too for different processes based on the system needs and its processes. Obviously the scheduling algorithm need for Linux server will be different from a mobile system that is running Linux. Now the scheduler selects the next process to be executed based upon the highest priority task. The highest priority task will run on the CPU over any lower priority task. And this task can be any of the belonging scheduling classes. One is the default scheduling classes that is provided by the CFS algorithm. Another is the real-time classes. Now these two classes can be added along with new classes at the time of the application developer is developing this kernel or Linux operating system. Rather than using strict rules that associates with a relative priority for each task in each class, the Linux kernel uses a value form known as nice value which is associated with each process. Now the nice values can range from minus 20 as it's the lowest one and plus 19 on this range as the highest one. Now the nice value will depend on the priority of the task and the term nice is coming from the idea that whenever a process is giving the new process or upcoming process in the system being nice to its lowering the relative priority, that is the nice process idea. The default time of the nice value is 0. Now, other than using the strict rules for time slices, the Linux kernel uses a targeted latency. This is the duration of time in which this interval every runnable process should run at least once time. Now, this targeted latency will determine the CPU processing time on which the nice value is depending. The nice value is depending on the proportion of the CPU processing time for each of the processes. Now the CPU proportion time will be given from the targeted latency. Now, addition with the default and minimum values for this targeted latency, it also increases the value of this targeted latency when a number of processes in a system goes larger and exceeded beyond a certain threshold. Now, other than assigning priority to a task, it actually Linux kernel records the how long process is running on the CPU. By maintaining a virtual runtime that is being used by a partask variable known as vRuntime. This vRuntime actually maintains the virtual runtime or the CPU runtime of a process and then maintains a record of it. The virtual runtime is based on a decay factor of the priority of a process, that the lowest priority process will have the highest decay factor and the highest priority process will have the lowest decay factor. Now, as we know that the normal priority is the nice value is 0, that is considered a normal decay or normal virtual runtime. Suppose for a normal priority, if a process is having 200 milliseconds of CPU proportion time, then it will be considered its virtual runtime also as 200 milliseconds. As for normal priority, the virtual runtime is equal to the actual physical runtime of that process. Now, if a higher priority process is having the same 200 millisecond physical runtime, then the virtual runtime will be always less than this 200 millisecond. And similarly, for a lower priority process will having this 200 millisecond physical runtime with a virtual runtime or larger than this 200 millisecond. In this way, the priorities can be assigned to based on the physical runtime and virtual runtime of the processes. Now, to decide that which task should run next, the scheduler selects the smallest virtual runtime with the highest priority process to allocate the CPU. Now, along with this one, if a higher process is available to run, then it will preempt a lower priority task. Now, to understand the virtual runtime or CFS scheduler's action, we assume that there are two processes, one is CPU bound and another is IO bound. And both of them are running on the processor. Now, if the IO bound processes is waiting for an IO, then it will have a short CPU burst time, then it will go for another waiting IO. The CPU bound process will again consider all its exhausted turnaround time or processing time by spending it allocation on the CPU. Now, obviously, the CPU bound process will give a lower priority, whereas the IO bound process will give a higher priority. And the IO will give in a lower virtual time that will run first before the virtual or CPU bound time will run. Now, if a CPU bound process is running and there an IO bound process has arrived, as the IO priority, it will preempt the CPU bound process to actually run its task. Linux also uses this real-time scheduling classes. Now, this real-time scheduling classes using the SCADE-FIFO or SCADE-ADA CPU scheduling policy, it gives the higher priority on any real-time classes over the normal or non-real-time classes. Now, any process belonging to class will execute first before any other task. Now, the Linux uses a numerical priority scheme that is associated to each class. Now, there is a fixed priority of the real-time classes that belong to the priority from 0 to 99. These processes have the highest priority over any other processes. Now, any normal task or non-real-time classes are put into the variable priority of 100 to 139. These priorities can be changed according to the demand of the processing time, the virtual runtime, or again the turnaround time. Now, the numerical priorities are then mapped to a global priority scheme where the lower numerical range stands for the higher priority and the higher numerical range stands for the lower priority. Now, the normal tasks are based on their nice values associated with them. The nice values from minus 19 to plus 20 is associating with the 100 to 139 priority of the normal class. In this way, Linux scheduling can be accomplished with the CFS, with the big O of 1, along with the virtual runtime policy. Thank you for watching this video. Stay tuned with Ikira and subscribe to Ikira.